often say is not worth being heard. And the Father's wisdom wanted to communicate his love. He spoke it in one final perfect word. His final word was Jesus. He needed no other one. Spoke flesh and blood so he could bleed and make a way divine. And so was born the baby who would die to make it mine. Took on flesh and bone. He spoke the living, luminous word. At once his will was done. And so the transformation that in man had been unheard took place in God the Father as he spoke that final word. He spoke the incarnation, and then so was born the Son. So was born the baby who would die to make it mine. And so the light became alive and manna became man. Eternity stepped into time so we could understand. He spoke the incarnation and then so was born the Son. Trust in a way that I cannot see. That's what faith must be. When the universe fell from his fingertips, he decided he wanted some fellowship. But the man and the woman would not submit, so he made a better way. When the moment was right, he sent his own son, and he opened the way so that everyone could have hope and believe that when time was done, they'd be able to make us one. Come on. To hear with my heart, to see with my soul, to be guided by a hand I cannot hold, to trust in a way that I cannot see. That's what faith must be. Now I understand that there is a key. It's Jesus in me, a reality. That God is in Christ, and that Christ's in me. That with faith I see what is unseen. One more time. To hear with my heart, to see with my soul, to be guided by a hand I cannot hold, to trust in a way that I cannot see. That's what faith must be. That's what faith must be. of history, a light so many strain to see, the one we talk so much about, but rarely ever live it out. Could you tell me why? Was it for this you came and died? A once a week observance when we coldly mouth your words. Lord, I long to see your presence in reality, but I don't know how. Let me know you in the now. We should confess, we lose you in our busyness. We've made you in our image, so our faith's idolatry. Lord, deliver me. Break my heart so I can see all the ways you dwell in us, that you're alive in me. Could it be you make your presence known so often by your absence? Could it be that questions tell us more than answers ever do? Could it be that you would really rather die than live without us? Could it be the only answer that means anything is you? Ebb and flow of living, as we wander through the years, we're told to listen to a voice we can't hear with our ears. They say to live by something that you can't see with your eyes. Is there really any purpose to this foolish exercise? Could it be you make your presence known so often by your absence? Could it be that questions tell us more than answers ever do? Could it be that you would really rather die than live without us? Could it be the only answer that means anything is you? In our words and in our silence, in our pride and in our shame, to the genius and the scholar, to the foolish and insane, to the ones who care to seek you, and to the ones who never will, you are the only answer, even still.
Let's sing it together, ready?
Could it be you make your presence known so often by your absence? Could it be that questions tell us more than answers ever do? Could it be that you would really rather die than live without us? Could it be the only answer that means anything is you? Could it be the only answer?
The Lord provided for a time for the slaves to be set free, for the debts to all be canceled, so his chosen ones could see. His deep desire was for forgiveness. He longed to see their liberty. And his yearning was embodied in the year of Jubilee. Come on. Jubilee. Jubilee. Jesus is the Jubilee. Debts forgiven. Slaves set free. Jesus is our Jubilee. At the Lord's appointed time, his deep desire became a man, the heart of all true jubilation, and with joy we understand. In his voice we hear a trumpet sound that tells us we are free. He is the incarnation of the year of Jubilee. Come on, sing. Jubilee, Jubilee. Jesus is the Jubilee. Debts forgiven, slaves set free. Jesus is our Jubilee. This is part. To be so completely guilty and given over to despair, to look into your judge's face and see a Savior there. Jubilee, Jubilee, Jesus is the Jubilee. Debts forgiven, slaves set free. Let's just say they'll all be sing-along songs tonight from this point on. My job gets a lot easier at that point. Well, I do want to welcome you. I don't think I've welcomed you yet. I want to welcome you in the name of the one who would rather die than live without you and me, the Lord Jesus. And the longer I do this, the more excited I get about simply getting together in his name and talking about him and singing about him and thinking about him and spending time with him in this way. The Nazarene had come to live the life of every man, and he felt the fascination of the stars. And as he wandered through this weary world, he wondered and he wept, for there were so few who listened to his call. Ready? Came, he saw, he surrendered all, so that we might be born again. And the fact of his humanity was there for all to see. He was unlike any other man, and yet so much like me. Nazarene could hunger, and the Nazarene could cry, and he could laugh with all the fullness of his heart. And those who hardly knew him, and those who knew him well, could feel the contradiction from the start. Come on. He came, he saw, he surrendered all, so that we might be born again. And the fact of his humanity was there for all to see, for he was unlike any other man, and yet so
so much like me.
One more time, ready?
He came, he saw, he surrendered all, so that we might be born again. And the fact of his humanity was there for all to see. For he was unlike any other man, and yet so much like me.
This is Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all of your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, does he? Or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. And hear this, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we're dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it's gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly host, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, O my soul. isn't that nice to just be quiet for a while? I want to talk just a second about something that I see as a great mystery. Paradox. You know, if you know me, you know I like to talk about them. You know what we as believers in Christ are called most often in the New Testament? It's not believers. It's not even Christians. You know, the word Christians doesn't happen very often. Only a couple of times, I think. I really should look it up and check, but I think it's only a couple of times. Most often, we're referred to as children. And increasingly, I mean, as an ongoing thing in my life, this is a theme that becomes more and more important to me. I talked about it a couple of years ago in concert, or maybe a year ago, and then started talking about something else. But then I keep returning to it because I guess I need to keep returning to it. And so I wanted to talk about it tonight. Becoming a child again. This is Matthew 18. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus did something sort of unexpected, which is what he usually did. He called a little child and had him stand among them, and he said, "I tell you the truth, unless you change," and you need to underline that in your Bible, "unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." What does Jesus mean when he tells us that we must change? And that's a mandate. Unless you do this, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So it's important. I mean, needless to say, it's important. What does he mean when he tells us that we need to become children again? We need to become like little children. Well, I believe it's one way of saying that we need to be like him. Because I'm convinced, the more I think about it, the more I pray about it, is to become more childlike is at the same time to become more Christ-like. Because when I look at the life of Christ in the Gospels, I see one who lived the life of a little child. And he would never encourage us to do or to be something that he is not himself. Look at the life of Jesus and think about it. He lived with great simplicity, like children live. He lived with reckless confidence, the way children live. I have a little three-year-old, well, I have two kids, but my three-year-old, Kate, lives with what I call reckless confidence. Because she knows that I and my wife, Susan, that we're on her side, right or wrong. Even if she's wrong, we're still on her side, and she knows it. And because she knows it, she lives recklessly, right on the edge. And because Jesus had such a confident relationship with the Father, "I do nothing except the Father tells me to do it. I say nothing except what the Father tells me to say," Jesus says when his back is against the wall. He lived with reckless confidence. If you don't see that in Jesus' life, you need to look. He was a reckless person, is a reckless person. Little children live in total dependence upon their parents. And in Jesus' life, we see a total dependence on the Father. Once again, "I do nothing except what the Father tells me to do. I say nothing except what the Father tells me to say." We talk a lot about the Holy Spirit, don't we? We have very little, I think, real understanding of what the Spirit does in our lives. But did you know that one of the primary purposes of the Holy Spirit is to enable you and me to call God Father? Galatians 4:6. "Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba." You and I are invited to imitate Christ, to become Christ-like, which means to become childlike, which means total dependence upon the Father, which means perhaps even not acting like adults. This is my life verse. My life verse used to be Psalm 119:9. But that's a long story. But this is my life verse now. It's Mark 10:16. This is Jesus and the little children once again. He's blessing them like a rabbi. He's giving them the Barocha, the rabbinic blessing, which is a very traditional Jewish thing to do. 10:16 says, "And he took the children in his arms. He put his hands on them and he blessed them." That's what I want in my life, and I hope that's what you want in your life.
A love he wanted us to know. He sent his only son and so became a holy embryo. That is the mystery. More than you can see. Give up on your pondering. Fiction as fantastic and wild, a mother made by her own child, hopeless babe who cried, was God incarnate and man deified. That is the mystery. Devastate, Creator must now recreate, and so to take our sin was made like us, so we could be like Him, and that is a mystery. Someone away to heaven, God the Son. Someday it's my prayer for you that in your heart his dream comes true. God the Son. Someday it's my prayer for you that in your heart his dream comes true. You do not sleep upon a stone, you have a bed to lay in, but you and Jacob aren't alone. We all need dreams to seek him. Dreaming Jacob's dream.
Children, help us to understand what it is to live like Christ, to be like him, to become like him. How much more important it is to protect them, not only to protect their happiness, but to protect their very lives in this day and age where people would throw their lives away. That's what this song's about.
That I heard crying coming through my door. Was it Rachel weeping for her sons who were no more? Could it have been the babies crying for themselves, never understanding that they died for someone else? A voice is heard of weeping and of wailing. History speaks of it on every page, of innocent and helpless little babies, offerings to the spirit of the age. Way of understanding the sad and painful sign. Whenever Satan rears his head, there comes a tragic time. If he could crush the cradle, then that would stop the cross. He knew that once the light was born, his every hope was lost. A voice is heard of weeping and of wailing. History speaks of it on every page, of innocent and helpless little babies, offerings to the spirit of the age. Soon all the ones who seem to die for nothing will stand beside the Ancient of Days. With joy we'll see that infant from the manger come and crush the spirit of the age. We'll see him crush the spirit of the age. for those who obey. And all those who seek it shall find it. A pardon for all who believe. Hope for the hopeless and sight for the blind.
Introduce the friends that have traveled long and hard, not just to come here, but over the last several years. On cello, you already know him, Mr. John Ketchum. Back on the piano is a new guy, Mr. Scott Brasher.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever, and give you peace, smile, and give you peace, and give you peace forever.
Now go in peace, you children of God.